Hi, my name is Todd Jokerst. I'm here at the Ludlum Training Center in Sweetwater, Texas. And the purpose of this video is to talk about the operations of the model 375P-336 radiation portal. It consists of the model 375 monitor, as well as two 41-inch plastic scintillators for radiation detection. Before I go into the operation of the Model 375, I'm going to talk about the three parameters which are really necessary to make to give you successful radiation detection. Those are time, distance, and shielding. And when I talk about time, I talk about how long a source such as these are next to the detector. And obviously, the longer you have the source next to the detector, the more likely I am to detect the radiation that's being emitted from it. So that's a parameter we'll talk about as we go through the operations. The second parameter is distance. How close is the source to the detector? And obviously, the closer I have it to the detector, the more likely I am to capture the radiation and detect it. And the final parameter I'm going to talk about is shielding. And when I speak about shielding, it's the material that is between the source and the detector. For the model 375P-336, it's capable of measuring beta particles as well as gamma radiation. So we're concerned about being able to shield the radiation coming from the source to the detector. And we'll talk about that when we get a little further into the operations. Now let's jump into the operation of the model 375P-336. As I mentioned before, it includes a 375 monitor, which will collect counts from two detectors, two scintillation detectors, which both you can see the inputs here for channel 1 and channel 2, feeds them into the monitor where it sums the counts and how much radiation that we're collecting. And I'm going to switch this on. When I do, you're going to see the lights, 8s come across the front, just indicating to you that all the numbers are working. And it will also light up a couple of the alarms here just to show that they're functioning also. You will notice that it's counting down now from 60, 54, 52. And what we're doing there is the unit is counting the background that's around the detectors in the room, because later we'll use that as a set point, or using a set point for the alarms that we're setting. So let's talk about now the alarm settings that we have within the model 375P. We have two primary alarms that you can set. One is a sum detector, which sums the contributions from both the scintillation detectors to provide a reading. In this case, we have 1.5 kilo counts per second, 1500 counts per second. You can set an alarm to have a threshold that if the counts go above that, you get an alarm. The second alarm that we have is called the sigma alarm. And sigma is based on background. One sigma is the square root of the background. So right now, since we don't have sources around, really, the square root of 1,500 counts per second would be equivalent to 1 second. And Drew will come up with that number for me, but it's going to be on the order of, 25 or something along those lines. So we set the sigma alarm. In this case, it's set, as I push the button here, to 20 sigma. So 20 times that square root of the background gives you my differential. And anything background plus that differential of 20 times the square root of the background would give you an alarm. That tends to be a very fast alarm. And really, this is the alarm that you're going to mostly see when you're using these as a portal. Okay? The last thing I want to talk about is the setting of these alarms, and how you can see that on the screen. If I push the sigma button, you'll see 20 sigma is the setting. If I push the sum alarm, you see that this is in terms of 10,000 counts per second is what the upper level is. Okay. So as you can see, I'm sitting here at 1,500 to get to 10,000. That factory setting is quite a bit higher than what you're normally going to see in background. Okay. So just to give you an idea of what to expect when you do get an alarm, I've got a small source here that I'm going to put in the vicinity of the detector. And you see that we get an alarm. This shows the channel 2 alarm, which that's my channel 2 detector. And we also, if you can hear, we do get an audio sound also. Now the audio sound right now I've got turned down fairly low, but you can move the baffles and make it quite a bit louder. So you get really a visual as well as audio, and that's what you should expect. The other thing you should notice is that as I move the source away, right now it's a non-latching alarm, and the alarm goes off by itself. Okay, as long as I kept that source near the detector, it would continue to alarm. As you see, the 375 is a fairly simple instrument. We've got a couple alarms. We've got a display that shows really the ongoing background for radiation. And so it's a simple instrument. However, to be confident that it's working, you should have routine functional checks of the instrument. That involves taking a source, putting it in the proximity, and making sure that we get an alarm. And even with the small sources such as this, this is about a half a microcurie of cesium-137. Even with a small source, within two or 3 seconds, it's going to alarm for you even faster. So you should validate that not only for the channel 1, but also on the channel 2 detector, which I'm ringing on this side, and to make sure that both sides work. In addition, one of the first things I do when I come to do a functional check is I make sure that the parameters, the sigma alarm is set at 20, if that's what you've got it set at, and the sum alarm is set at the value that I expect it to be 2. In case someone has changed it along the way or somehow it's gotten out of spec. So those are usually pretty functional check. I want to put a source in front of it. I want to check and make sure my parameters are there. I want to make sure that I'm ringing. And also if I've got a secondary strobe, which I do in this case, that it's alarming also. Okay. Now let's talk about the setup of the 375P. If I remove the calibration cover, you see that we've got four different dip switches and two arrows to move the parameter numbers. And I'll show you how to set this up, because we've got two alarms in there. As you remember, we have the sigma alarm that's set currently at 20, and the sum alarm, which is set at 10,000 counts per second. We have four different dip switches here. As you can see, we label them here. The first one is the cal mode. Right now, the instrument is in cal lock, so I can't change any of the parameters. In order to change parameters, I need to move that switch over to the right, and now I can change the parameters. So if I, for instance, press on the sigma alarm and move the arrow, I can move the values up and down, and we can change and get a more sensitive reading, say at 18 sigma. Okay. Same goes for the sum alarm. Right now it's set at 10,000. Counts per second, we can make that lower if you like, okay? That's just as easy as it is to set those alarm. We have a few other dip switches here. The second one is latching alarm. What happens when you get an alarm? Does it latch? Latch means that it stays on until someone comes and touches one of these buttons and acknowledges it. Currently, as you saw earlier, when we get an alarm and I move the source away, the alarm goes off. It's in the non-latch mode. That's with the dip switch number 2 all the way to the left. If I moved it to the right, it would alarm until someone came and pushed either the sum button or the sigma button. The third one down is detectors 1 and 2. What this means is that normally you have two detectors that are operating, feeding into the monitor, but you can have situations where you have a damaged detector, or maybe you just have one detector for whatever reason. It can operate with one detector only. When you do that, if you have that situation, though, I must tell you that you need to bring the cabling in from that detector into channel 1, because it expects to see one detector from channel 1. The last one we have here is the calculation time, which is either half a second or 2 seconds. What that calculation time is doing is when I'm bringing the source up to the detector, it's starting to see a growth in the number of counts. And if we have it set, factory default is at 2 seconds, it looks at a 2 second interval and tries to say, ooh, where's it going? And whether am I exceeding that sigma alarm? We can also put that at for a half a second if you want faster response. It will look at a half second interval and evaluate whether it's reached the sigma alarm or not. And I must warn you though, that a lot of people say, wow, I want the best sensitivity as I can, the fastest alarm. You know, all natural background radiation is random, and so you do get fluctuations. And if you've got the sigma alarm down low, say at 10 or 15, and you've got it in a half second, you can get situations where really there's no sources present, but you'll get, you know, for a few seconds, get something over the alarm, and you'll get a false alarm. So there's good and bad with these settings. If you, the more sensitive you get, the more likely you are to get false alarms. All right. So once I've completed setting my parameters, and the way I can tell if I've moved the switch yet is, can I still move it? I wanted it at 18. I move it to 18. I lock this in really by moving that switch back to the left side. And now I'm locked in, and someone can't inadvertently change it. Then I put the cowl cover back on, and I'm set ready to go. So the last thing I want to talk about is response. And your response to alarms are going to vary from location to location and dependent on your needs. But in general, people respond to these similarly. Okay, so I get an alarm, right? We decide in this case it's a non-latching alarm, but the alarm goes off. Someone was moving waste by the portal monitor, and they got an alarm. Typically what happens at that point, in that waste container that you were wheeling by, you know that there's a bag or two of waste in there that's got radioactive material that we can sense. And so at that point, normally they back away into the dirty side of the portal, if we want to call it that, and we'll take bags out one at a time, move it through the portal to find which bag or bags is offending. Then they'll typically take those bags that are offending. If you're at a nuclear medicine facility, normally that's Tech 99 or something with a very short half-life, 6 hours, things like that. You know that, hey, I can move that off into a shielded room or a room that's locked, and within a couple days, really there's no detectable radioactivity in it. So typically, folks who get the alarms, they identify the bag, and then move them and sequester those bags until they've decayed enough that they're safe to put send off into municipal waste. But every location is going to have a little difference. As we've talked about, you may have different sigma levels, you may have different some alarms, you may want it latched or not latched, but we're here to help you set up any way you want. As we've seen earlier today, we had a strobe light, we also have horns, we've got Ethernet connections if you want to have software that monitors these things. Anything you can think of, I'm guaranteeing that we've already done with 375, and just ask, we're here to help you. The last thing I just want to say is I invite you to go on YouTube and look up other Ludlum's videos that are out there. We've got a great deal of videos out there to help you and assist you to use our equipment correctly and properly. Thanks again.